Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, everybody. This is Michael Bamberger, and it's a great pleasure to have the opportunity to share with you our experiences on how to conduct evaluations in the real world and how to make evaluations useful for strengthening country-led monitoring and evaluation systems. I will discuss a few of the general issues and why we believe this approach is important, and then Jim will go into more detail on some of the tools and techniques. The basic concern that we're addressing is the fact that a very large number of impact evaluations use very weak evaluation designs. While textbooks provide us with a lot of very good indications on rigorous evaluation designs, very few evaluators are actually able to use these very strong designs. And as a result, most assessments of the impacts of development programs use very weak methodologies. And many of the claims about project impact are not really justified by the evaluation designs which are being used. And very often, there is a positive bias in the evaluation findings. The reason for this is that when working with a very little budget and a tight time deadline, very often the evaluators will only talk to the beneficiaries or to the stakeholders who are directly involved in the project, and they all tend to give a fairly positive impression of how the project is working, and very often the evaluation does not talk to any of the people who are not beneficiaries or people who may even be worse off as a result of the project. So very often the evaluation reports, when conducted with a real-world budget and time constraints, present a very positive bias and give a misleading impression about the amount of impacts that a project has produced. And also, almost no evaluation reports systematically discuss the validity of the methodology that they've been using. So even when they're using very weak methodologies, this tends not to be discussed or recognized, and the implications are not presented in the evaluation findings. So we had a concern that there's a very big weakness in the evaluation field because the evaluation designs are not really adapted to the realities under which they're conducted. The reasons for this are, firstly, that almost everybody conducts evaluations with time constraints. You never have enough time. There are also budget and resource constraints. Nobody ever has enough money. You may also not have enough professional staff to conduct the evaluation. And then there are always, very frequently, data constraints. This is particularly true when the evaluation doesn't begin until towards the end of the project, which is probably the most common situation. So very often there's no baseline data. You're trying to measure changes and impacts, but you don't have a reliable baseline from which to begin. Or if you do have some baseline data, that the quality may be very, very poor. Often the people who are reporting in the monitoring system may have an incentive not to mention problems or to present the things in the best possible light. So very often you're working with very poor data, and also you're operating under political constraints that in many countries there is no evaluation culture. There's very limited understanding of the value of evaluation. Many agencies are very unwilling to accept criticism, or maybe they don't have professional staff to be able to help interpret and understand the findings of the evaluation. So very often you're trying to present evaluation findings or conduct evaluations in a culture where the clients don't really understand this. And then there's a very widespread perception that information should be used as a political tool rather than to present an objective understanding of the program. So either the clients are selectively using the evaluation findings to make their program look good, or the critics are selectively pointing out the criticisms in the evaluation to make the program look bad. So these political constraints are very important in terms of trying to strengthen evaluation. we have developed, and Jim will talk more about this, a real-world evaluation approach of providing guidance on how to conduct evaluations when working under these constraints. And this model, which is you can see in more detail in the UNICEF publication, basically has seven steps. You need to begin with a planning and scoping the evaluation. You need to understand the client's needs. You need to develop a program theory model so that the evaluation is really explaining and testing what it is that people believe the project is doing and how it will be achieving its objectives. And then you need to make sure that the evaluation design is realistic within the budget and time constraints that you're facing. And you need to make sure that you are assessing the validity of the evaluation and that you are ensuring you're achieving minimum acceptable methodological standards. We then developed a number of strategies for addressing, if you have budget constraints, there are ways that you can reduce the cost of the evaluation. If you have time constraints, there are ways that you can reduce the time. You can use the time more efficiently. You can have a more efficient way that you use the expensive consultants who are only available for a short period of time. There's a series of strategies for addressing data constraints. And one of the things we've worked on a lot is how you can reconstruct baseline data when the evaluation doesn't begin until late in the project, how you can try and estimate what the conditions were at the time the project began. And then there's a number of strategies for understanding and trying to accommodate to political constraints while recognizing that different stakeholders have different priorities and perspectives. So very often you can't reach a general agreement, but at least you can recognize the differences and try and reflect them in how the evaluation is conducted. And then we have developed a strategy for assessing the strengths and weaknesses of the evaluation designs using what we call a threats to validity checklist. And there's references to this in the publication. And then finally, it's critical to make sure that the you are helping the clients to use evaluation. Many evaluations are methodologically very strong, but nobody ever uses them. So we put a great emphasis on designing, implementing evaluations in a way to maximize the likelihood that they will be utilized. Then my final three slides are addressing the questions that Marco presented, how real-world evaluation contributes to country-led monitoring and evaluation. Firstly, how to increase the uptake of evidence and its use in policy making. A first point is to make sure that stakeholders are involved actively in the design, implementation, analysis, and dissemination of the evaluation. We also believe it's very important to base the evaluation on a program theory, a logic model, so you really are testing the issues, the hypotheses which clients consider important. Many evaluations are testing things which the clients don't agree are the actual way that the program is working. So this is very, very important. Make sure the evaluation is focusing on clear key issues to your clients. Then it's also critical how you present the findings. When do you present them? They need to be presented when the information is needed. You need to use the communication style of your clients. Not everybody likes a 100-page report with 50 tables. Some people prefer an informal presentation. Some people prefer a verbal presentation rather than having to read reports. It's very, very important to make sure that you're presenting the findings in a way which will be acceptable and understandable to the clients. Then the quality challenge that Marco was discussing. A first point is to adapt the evaluation design to the level of rigor required by decision makers. Sometimes evaluations are more rigorous than they need to be. In other cases, they're not as rigorous as the clients would like them to be. So there isn't one correct level of methodological rigor. You need to adapt both to your resources and also to the needs of the decision makers. Then we've already mentioned using the threats to validity checklist. So you can identify the strengths and weaknesses of the evaluation at the beginning of the evaluation cycle, during the evaluation when there's still time to correct problems, and towards the the end so you can assess how good the evaluation was. Then you need to ensure that you have minimum acceptable levels of methodological rigor. Many evaluations don't reach the minimum levels, and this is something critical to make sure that you do understand what the minimum acceptable level is. Then avoiding positive bias, even when you have a very tight budget, making sure you do talk to people who are not beneficiaries, people who criticize the program, so you get a more balanced view. Then finally, how do you adapt the country-led real-world evaluation to the country-led monitoring evaluation system? Firstly, you need to adapt your national system to the constraints under which you're working. There's no point having a beautiful, rigorous evaluation system if you don't have the resources or the staff or the data to implement it. Then it's critical that your national system is producing useful and actionable information, and also you're doing this as quickly as possible. If people have to wait 3 years before they get any results, they will lose interest in the evaluation system. Then also there isn't any one size fits all. There are different administrative political systems in different countries, and you need to adapt your evaluation design to these systems to make sure that it is acceptable and understandable and works in a particular context. Then it's very important to focus on institutionalizing the evaluation system, not just conducting ad hoc evaluations whenever any funding is available from donors or a particular minister is interested. Very few countries do this. They normally focus on trying to do a limited number of good evaluations without really building up the system to use the results to ensure continuity. Then evaluation capacity development is critical. And finally, the need to focus on quality assurance to make sure that you do have guidelines for assessing the quality and communicating to the clients what the strengths and weaknesses are of the evaluations you've conducted. So thank you very much. I will now pass you over to Jim Rugh.
Thank you, Michael, for that introduction. And it's unfortunate that the video did not work for Marco or for Michael. I'll try and turn mine on here and see if that works. Unfortunately, you can move that, you can close that screen if you don't want to see my face, but let's go on with the slides. And just to summarize the overall approach that Michael and I have been talking about is this the book, Real World Evaluation. And let me just say that we normally have a full day workshop, and we're now doing a 20-minute condensation of that. So some of these things we'll just talk about very briefly. But overall, it's an integrated approach, and that's an important word, integrated, the multiple methods, of acceptable standards and methodological rigor, which means we're not just trying to be sloppy and just get by with what we've got, but trying to do it as well as possible, yet under those constraints that we have talked about. So here are those challenges. All too often, project designers don't think about evaluation until just near the end of the project, especially if the donor is asking them to have an evaluation before they do the next phase, and it's done in haste and not very well done. Often because it was not thought of until the end, there wasn't a baseline, at least not one that was comparable to the evaluation. Very rarely do you see any possible comparison group to know what the counterfactual was, as to what would have happened if the project were not there. And as we've said, limited time. Too often, consultants are asked to come out and do an impact evaluation. They're told they just have a couple of weeks and a small budget, and it's just not possible to do as much as the clients may be asking for. And in terms of those political constraints, one of them is that the clients have expectations for what the evaluations will say. We want you to have a positive evaluation so we get the next funds. Or they may also have a particular bias in terms of the methodology that should be used. It should be a quantitative survey, or it should be participatory. We need to factor that in. And many stakeholders do not understand evaluation. Too many of them think of it just as a judgment, and of course we try to avoid that, and it's hard to get them to collaborate with that. Appropriate evaluation design is one section of the workshops and the book, and I want to focus on that a little while here. Once you know what the client's information needs really are and how rigorous and how accurate the evaluation should be, given the constraints, and the evaluator and the client need to negotiate together just how well the design can meet those needs and address those various circumstances. Let me just go through a series, and this is only a portion of what we use in the workshops, of looking at evaluation designs. And my have two purposes for doing this. One is, as we take away each of these elements of an ideal longitudinal quasi-experimental kind of design, we have to decide what can we do to fill in the blanks that if those things were not there. And this is what I propose as kind of a comprehensive evaluation design, where you have a baseline, midterm, end of project evaluation, and even a post-project, ex-post evaluation a couple years later to see whether or not there really was a sustainable impact. And ideally, you have some sort of comparison group. And the lines I've drawn on this graph show in this example that though during the life of the project, the participants were doing better than the comparison group, later on, they did not do so well, so it was not sustainable. But it took this much information to find that out. So what happens when we start removing some of those elements? What if we did not have an ex-post evaluation or even a midterm evaluation? We just have a before and after and with and without. In Cairo 6 weeks ago, many of us were talking about impact evaluation, and the whole heated argument is whether or not it can be randomly assigned. And part of my point here is if you think of this as a map of many different evaluation designs, randomizing is only one piece of a much bigger puzzle. And in the typical so-called experimental design, it's still only before and after, with and without, four snapshots. It doesn't give you much to talk about what happened during the life of the project or what happened after the project, looking at the black box that happened during the life of the project. In this evaluation model, there was not a baseline, but somewhere during the life of the project, there was a midterm evaluation. So you need to have a comparison over a shorter time span as to what happened. Here's an example where there was a baseline, but only the participants were in the baseline. So you have a before and after with them. For the comparison group, even if you found one at the end of the project, you have to fill in the gaps in terms of identifying what was the situation for that comparison group at the time of the baseline. Is there some way we can do recall or look into secondary data or talking to key informants to find out how comparable they were even from the beginning? Under this design, there was no baseline for either the participants or the comparison group. It was only an end of the project evaluation, and they found some sort of comparison group. So in both cases, you have to do some recall as to what was life like for the participants, what was it like for the comparison group in terms of the main indicators we're looking for, and try and identify what kind of change occurred over that time. Here's a design without any comparison group, no counterfactual, but at least a before and after. And that's better than this final design. Number 7 is where you only have a measurement at the end of the project. And unfortunately, from the experience that Michael and I have had and some of the meta-evaluations that I've done and from what we've heard from colleagues, this is more typical of what often we are ending up doing. We have to do an evaluation at the end of a project. Even if we measure that indicator very accurately, we don't know what to compare it to. So a big part of the real-world evaluation approach is to try and retroactively find out what the trends were, what happened before, what the comparison was, so we have something to compare it with. So backing up in terms of the first step that Michael showed in that 7-step series that we have, what are the key questions, who asks them, what evidence would inform them, and I like very much the introduction that Marco gave in terms of trying to make it relevant to policymakers. We can have a technically very rigorous evaluation, but if it doesn't make any sense to the policymakers, it's not going to be helpful. Why are we doing the evaluation? Will it be another phase? Will other projects be designed based on this? If not, well, why spend a lot of time doing an impact evaluation? But indeed, if it's a pilot project and it'll be multiplied many times over for a much bigger population, we do need to make sure the rigor is quite high. And as Patricia Rogers showed us when we were in Cairo, she used a matrix of simple, complicated, or complex. And here's a slide that kind of summarizes that matrix that she gave, which I found is very helpful because it seems to me when you talk about randomized controlled trials, often you're only referring to a very simple scenario where you have one indicator, one cause and effect chain, and in much of the developing world that all of us deal with, things are much more complicated. You have multiple inputs from different actors. You have multiple contributing factors to the change you're looking for. And in the complex world, things are changing as you go along. So it's very hard to fit a very simplistic design into the real world that we deal with. Other questions that we have to answer when we do an evaluation, what do we mean by impact? And very often it's not just one indicator. Is it feasible to expect a clear linear attribution? Too many times, as I said, that the higher level of things we refer to as impact in terms of improved quality of life or the indicators related to the Millennium Development Goals require multiple inputs to achieve them. And